Hi everyone, thanks for checking out Exotic PC's video review of the Sager NP8651. For hardware, it's a 15.6 inch screen, 1920 by 1080. There is a 4K option coming up shortly, hopefully early to mid-December. We'll have that 4K available. For the CPU, we're looking at the Intel i7-4710HQ, which is a 2.5 to 3.5 gigahertz processor. Now that processor is not upgradable. For the video card, it's the NVIDIA GTX 970M with 3 gigs of built-on video memory. For the RAM, it comes standard with 8 gigs of RAM. It is upgradable to 32 gigs. For the hardware slots, it's a little unique on this one. It does have one mini PCI Express or mSATA on there, another one that's mSATA only, and then two hard drive bays. But you can have two hard drive bays if they're both SSD drives or just one HDD drive. There's no optical drive with it. For the Wi-Fi, the standard one comes included with it, or you can upgrade to the Intel AC7260. For Windows, there is no Windows by default included. If you have your own, you can install your own, or on our configuration page, you can select Windows 8. There may be some versions of Windows 7 still available. Those are running out, but Windows 7 or 8 will work on there. For the warranty, we're looking at 1 year parts and limited lifetime labor warranty provided by Exotic PC. For our dimensions, width-wise, we're at 15.16. Depth, we're at 10.67. And a height of 0.98. So just under an inch on height. For the weight, we're at 5.5 pounds, and that is including the battery. All right, so we're going to take a look into the computer, check benchmarks, go over the ports and everything like that that we normally do. But thanks for taking your time to check this out. As you can see, there is a brushed metal exterior finish on the back of the LCD panel here. This is also matching the material that is found by the palm rest by the touchpad there. You can't see it real good here, but to the left and right of the palm rest or the touchpad, it is that same material there. We're going to take a look at the screen viewing angles. Got our colorful gradient up in front of us here. This is dead on. We'll go ahead and spin it off. And really what we're looking for is any type of washout. So as we spin it off, viewing angles typically will get a little bit worse, especially on TN type panels. And you can see it's a little washed out here off of the edge. Nothing real bad, but definitely not the same color as being dead on compared to right there. See that, and then we'll go back off to the left so you can see any color shift. And we'll spin it off to the right, see if we get any type of color shift as well. I'm trying to really see if I can see that in person. I see it picking it up on the camera, and how much I actually see that in person. It does have a little bit of color wash. I think it's a little bit more dramatic on the camera as in real person, but there is some wash out there. I'll go ahead and pull the screen down. Slowly open it back up so we can see how the colors shift. And I'll go ahead and lean it back. So there was definitely more color shift as we pulled it forward than leaning it back. Leaning it back, definitely not bad at all. I'll pull this straight forward here. And that really gets us our viewing angles of the 1920 by 1080 screen. We're taking a look at the keyboard here. As you can see, it's a full size. That includes the number pad off to the right of it. 15.6 inch, 17.3 inch computers will always have that. It is a chiclet style, which is nice. What we've been seeing lately with Sager computers, they have been using an island style. Some people like it, some people don't. Chiclet's one of the most popular ones out there. So you can see that is included. Take a look at the touchpad here. There's a left click and right click. And then there's a fingerprint reader in the middle of that too. So you can use that for security, passwords. Instead of typing things in, you can just run your fingerprint across it. You can also see the WASD keys there. So for your gamers, that's set off to the side, highlighted by the red arrows. And the keyboard is also backlit. So let me see if I can get that for you. I'm going to turn off the light. Let me first turn it on so I can see what I'm doing. You can't really see it right there, but I'll go ahead and kill the light. And there you can see it a little bit better. Just function F4 is how you control that. There is a off, low, and high setting on there. So three different settings, just depending on your environment and how bright you want the keys there. Let's turn the light back on. We'll take a look at the Flex. I'll go ahead and start giving it a press as if I was just normally typing. So you can see there's really no flex there. Now if I start pressing down on it, right in the middle, a little bit of flex. But you know, if you force it, it's going to happen. Off to the corners. Definitely not bad flex at all out there. There's a little bit, but nothing out of the ordinary. On normal typing situations, you should be fine on there. And then just real quick, let's finish up the touchpad. Again, it is flush with the rest of it. It is a different material. As you can see, the brushed metal on the left and right, but the touchpad itself is not that. Separated left click and right click. Let's take a look at the ports of the computer. We're starting on the left-hand side. You're going to see first an exhaust vent, followed by HDMI out, USB 3.0, and then two mini display ports, 1.2s there. On the front left-hand side, we're looking at our status indicator lights. We'll come back to those and go over those in a second. Nothing else on the front-hand side. On the right side, starting off with the SPDIF, then your microphone and headphone jack. Got your memory card reader, so things like your secure digital card you can put in there. And then a SIM card reader. Two more USB 3.0 ports. That's your Ethernet and then your Kensington lock there. There is another exhaust port on the back side here. Then you can see your AC adapter plug-in. That is a eSATA / USB combo port. And we're going to finish it off back on the left-hand side where we started off. Right, here's a better view of the status light indicator. Starting on the left, you'll see the light to the left of it indicates that it's working. So first off, we got our turbo boost. Then we have our scroll lock, caps lock, number lock. Airplane mode, basically letting you know if your Wi-Fi is on or off. Got your hard drive activity light, followed by your battery. So if it's plugged in, that battery light will be on. And then just the power indicator on there. So the computer's turned on, and you'll see that light is on. All right, we'll take a look at the boot up time. This is with the standard 7200 RPM hard drive on there, so we're not expecting blazing speeds. You know, if you've got the PCI Express mini card or a mSATA or a SSD technology, anything like that, it should be a lot quicker, but we'll go ahead and check it out anyway. So got the phone set up. I'll hit power and start at the same time. So we'll go 3, 2, 1, go. And I'll do my best to stop that once we get to the desktop. There we have a minute and 2 seconds, which is not surprising considering it's a hard disk drive on there. If you want to cut that down to 10 to 15 seconds, get one of those solid state drive options in there and you'll really see those boot times cut down, as well as just overall program start time and all the benefits the SSD gets you. All right, we'll take a look into the BIOS. So the computer's off, I'll go ahead and turn it on and then start spamming F2 right away. And that'll get us right into the BIOS. So let's just do an overview of what's here. On the main page is showing your SATA ports and what's connected to it. And then down a little bit further, you're going to see just basic information, the video card in there, system memory, BIOS version, EC version. Let's go to the advanced tab where I have the advanced chipset control. So you have your Intel virtualization technology and your combo slot. Intel rapid start technology. Get our SATA mode, HCI, if you had a RAID on there, that's where you would change that up. Boot logo, so that's just the Sager logo as you turn on the computer. Power on, boot beep, low battery alarm, you can enable or disable those. Security, where you can set your password. Your boot options, of course, that's where you configure your boot priorities. Hard drive BBS priorities. Network device BBS priorities, and UEFI settings. And then there's the exit. So we'll just hit escape to exit and not save any changes, but a pretty simple BIOS that we have. Once you do that, it'll reboot itself. All right, we're gonna go ahead and run 3DMark Firestrike as our first benchmark. I do have hardware monitor running in the background as well as MSI Afterburner, so we can look over the temps of the CPU and GPU once we're done. As usual, we will be overlaying our thermal pictures so you can see what type of heat is generated and where it's generated. I'll put this microphone back down by the GPU exhaust vent so you can hear how the fans ramp up as the computer gets under load. And of course, we'll be reviewing the results once it's all done. Okay, 3DMark Firestrike's all finished up. We'll take a look at the score here. As you can see, 6,482. Graphics score, 7,400. Physics score, 9,223. And a combined score of 2,728. Again, this is with the GTX 970M, and that is a 3GB version. Let's take a look at the CPU temperatures here. I got hardware monitor pulled up. And you can see 74, 77, up to 81. So we'll just say 74 to 81. I'll scroll down a little bit and take a look at the GPU temperatures. and 65 Celsius. So it's a really good temperature. Now this model does have dual fans for the GPU, so that's what's helping it get that really low GPU temperature out of there. Let's just verify that with MSI Afterburner. And this one's always hard to see. It looks like it actually didn't pick it up there. So no results on MSI Afterburner, but the GPU results on hardware monitor seem to be right where we have been seeing temperatures reported for this particular model. So everything looks good there. Let's run another benchmark and see how the numbers look. All right, we got our second benchmark, 3D Mark Skydiver, finished up here. Take a look at the scores, 18,410. Graphics score, 24,612. Physics score, 8,501, with a combined score, 16,135. So performance right where they should be. Let's take a look at temperatures. We got our CPU's temperatures right here, anywhere from 88 to 92 to 93. And then we'll take a look at the GPU score, 66 right there. So very low temperatures on the GPU. CPU could be a little bit lower, definitely. Something better, maybe Icy Diamond Thermal Compound, a notebook cooler to prop up the bottom of the computer to get better airflow. Definitely could help that out. All right, we got our second benchmark, 3D Mark Skydiver, finished up here. Take a look at the scores, 18,410. Graphics score, 24,612. Physics score, 8,501. With a combined score, 16,135. So performance right where they should be. Let's take a look at temperatures. We got our CPU's temperatures right here, anywhere from 88 to 92 to 93. And then we'll take a look at the GPU score, 66 right there. So very low temperatures on the GPU. CPU could be a little bit lower, definitely. Something better, maybe Icy Diamond Thermal Compound, a notebook cooler to prop up the bottom of the computer to get better airflow. Definitely could help that out. We'll take a look at the internals of the computer. There are a few screws around the perimeter that you do have to take off, a few in the middle, so just make sure you undo all the screws that you see. I've gone ahead and already done that, and once you do, you can go ahead and pop open the bottom. And it lifts away very easily, as you can see. So we'll go ahead and start off on the left-hand side here. That's going to be your regular hard disk drive, so that's 2.5 inch, and again, you can do one hard disk drive or two solid state drives in there. The other mounting ones underneath of that. So that's kind of why you're restricted there. Here's the, it's an M.2 SATA slot is there. There's another one over here. Okay, so you got the two. I believe this is gonna be the one that is the mini PCI Express. Got your wireless card. This is also an M.2 wireless card. Right here is your dual exhaust for the GPU. And you can see the heat transfer pipes are going actually over here to where the GPU is. So those transfer the heat over where the fins are, the fans exhaust out. And you may have noticed here you do have some intake for the GPU and the CPU. So you want to make sure you do not block those, or else you will have overheating issues. Going off to the other side, that's your CPU fan, and you can follow the heat transfer pipes over to where the CPU is at right there. You have two RAM slots here. I believe the other two are going to be on the other side of the motherboard. And then you have the battery. So it's an internal battery, not one that's easily removed in and out. It can be removed should you absolutely need to, just by disconnecting it, but not to be, not designed to be done very easily there. That's going to finish up our look at the Sager NP8651. So I want to thank you for taking your time to check it out. Hopefully you got some information from us. If you have any other questions, contact us. Best way? Our website, www.exoticpc.com. You can email sales@exoticpc.com. Call us. It's 1-877-289-9684. We also have our live chat available where we actually chat online with real people. We're available in there from 9 to 5:30 p.m. Central Time, Monday through Friday. If you have any questions, comments, leave them below. And of course, give us a thumbs up if you like it. And of course, subscribe to the channel, as we do make these video reviews quite often. We try to shoot for at least one a week. So keep up on all the new computers coming out. Thanks for your time. Have a good one.